today's webinar is all about action items. What I'd want to do is to go on and give you best practices for cybersecurity. We've heard a lot of best practices going in and out. Organizations like the DHS, the Department of Homeland Security, stepping in. The organizations like NSA stepping in and giving away best practices for cybersecurity. What is the reason behind so much noise around this specific space? At ManageEngine, we've been doing quite some research around cybersecurity and identity management. So that's exactly what we want to share with you today. We'll start off with a quick understanding of how to break it down first. What's the take that we have for today? When it comes to how identities were handled a while back, it was all about identities being an important component of your management, as to how hierarchies functioned in the organization, as to how entitlements were given. And that was pretty much it. And for most part of the time, identities were inside your organization, well within the perimeter. But for a change, now in the last one decade, if you were to observe, or if I were to be a lot more specific, in the last 5 years, there's been a tremendous push towards hybrid and the cloud. That being said, identity is no longer just inside your organization or well within your boundaries. It's very much on the perimeter. That's something that we'll have to definitely take into consideration, because when you're trying to do a security strategy for your organization, the very first touch point is going to be a login, is going to be your users. And as I always like to say, the security of an organization is only as strong as the weakest link. And in most cases, the weakest link, just like you guessed, I'm pretty sure you guys have a big smile on your face, users, they are the weakest link. So how do you ensure that despite the fact we try to give them all the mobility, we try to give them identities that can be carried along with them, there still seems to be an issue of them confirming to the practices that you have in place? Because it's always, bottom line, it's going to be security versus usability. There is this resistance among users to follow the practices that you have for them. That's a big challenge. So re-ideating or re-strategizing your cybersecurity with identities on the perimeter is my recommendation, or the first recommendation that I have for you today. So start right there and things are going to be straightforward. If you get that one bit of it right, because we're talking about take into consideration users who are on the go. As a matter of fact, we've got statistics that tells us that about 10 to 11% of workforce in the entire states is on the go, is either salespeople on the go, is either people working from home, all these companies becoming cool day in, day out, letting their employees work from home. But that does bring in quite a few challenges. And let's not even get into bringing their own devices. BYOD, that's a big thing again. We're talking about identities becoming very consumeristic. Your users no longer want to just get to work and then log in, but then they want to have all these access on the go, be able to access all of it. We're talking about Office 365, G Suite, not just Active Directory anymore. So that being the case, the threat landscape or the attack landscape as such is larger, and larger the attack landscape, greater the probability of someone making a mistake. We keep hearing about password credentials being compromised all the time. We keep hearing about privilege escalations happening all the time. Why? We cannot necessarily blame an IT administrator right here. I'm pretty sure we've got a couple of CISOs joining me today, and we guys understand how the landscape works right now. One vulnerability is all that an attacker needs to get into your system. Because if you look at it, it seems like quite a normal organization. Everybody is seeming to be having a good day, good time. But if you look close, that may not be the case. We are talking about a situation or a point of time where we can very much have insiders working in tandem with probably a hacker outside, or the insider very much could be an attacker trying to exfiltrate data. That is a probable case. We cannot neglect that. And as a matter of fact, as to how these attackers work, they seem to know your users better than you do. Now, I'm pretty sure it comes a little striking, but that's the kind of rigor with which the attackers work. All that they are looking for is one weak spot. They stalk your users. They try and understand the entire profile. They wait for that one weak spot. It's all about them figuring out probably when your user went out for a coffee break with their desktop unlocked. Probably if a remote session was not terminated properly. So these are small cases, but then could essentially bring down the entire cybersecurity of your organization. So what do we do right there? In fact, organizations like Microsoft, they've come forward, they've given away information. That's a little disturbing, but then it's important that we start acknowledging the possibility of us being not 100% secure. What do we do? The infographic right here is something that I want you to take note of. When it comes to identity management, which is the epicenter of your entire IT and most problems, about 80% of your cybersecurity problems are around something or the other that has to do with identities. So that being said, Active Directory is among the most commonly used platforms. You could be on-prem or you could be on the cloud or you could be using a hybrid of AD and AAD or Azure AD. Despite all of the measures that have been taken, the infographic writer very clearly points out that if there's one compromise, all that the attacker needs is just one entry point. If that's done, if the first host is compromised, within just 48 hours, in less than 2 days' time, the domain admin can be compromised. With the current settings these IAM tools have, it just takes that much time. And the damage today is going to be all the more colossal because it's not just AD that we are talking about, we are also talking about a lot of other integrated solutions, Office 365 for that matter, and what goes along with it. So we are talking about a very big problem of data being exfiltrated, and this happening over a course of time, maybe let's say a couple of months. And by the time you actually realize that the attacker has been in your system, it takes months. So what's the major problem? Organizations have started realizing this. You can't call yourself 100% secure. So that is a given. One thing that you could probably do is rethink your security strategy. Start considering the possibility of an attacker existing in your system or already lurking in your system as we speak. I know this sounds a little scary, but then facts are facts. You never know. You can't be 100% sure. So start acknowledging the possibility and see how you alter your security strategy to be proactive. Have systems in place that can smartly notify you when something's off, when something's deviated, when something is not usual. Have systems like that that lets you essentially identify. So no matter how hard we try, we still always keep coming back to the first point, which is our users falling prey. So we talk about attacks happening day in, day out, and quite strikingly, we see still phishing attacks on the rise. In fact, phishing attacks have been here for quite some time. I'm pretty sure administrators around the world have told their users time and time again not to click an email that says do not open. What's the first reaction that our users have? They open the email, and if it has an attachment that says do not download, that's the exact thing that they do. We are talking about advanced scams, advanced attackers. They try to impersonate. They try to buy your trust. They go to the extent of grooming themselves well. They speak the business lingo. They gain your trust. They take some time to exchange the information. In fact, these conversations that we're talking about, a couple of examples that we just had a few months back, have attackers talking to users inside the organization for months together before they actually get hold of the intellectual property or get hold of some wire transfer. So we're talking about attackers becoming extremely smart. We see an major rise in account takeover. So all of this essentially builds up to this one aspect of them trying to take over your identity. So your cybersecurity's first touch point being identity, if that gets taken down, even before you know, they get into your organization, try and laterally move, establish as much as control as possible, understand where your critical resources are, find out which resources are going to be helpful for them, maybe in terms of money, maybe in terms of damage that they could cause, and then they complete their mission over a course of time without tipping any of the radar or the SIEM solutions that you've got and then get out without a trace. They completely delete the trace. So how do you go forward? So what would essentially help you is to understand and acknowledge the possibility and check if you can have measures in place to attack the attacker's mindset. So we ran a survey among top administrators across organization, and we have IT managers agreeing to the fact that they are traumatized. They are prone to some attack or the other all the time. We're talking about Office 365, and that turned out to be the biggest bummer of 2019. So many Office 365 issues that the Department of Homeland Security had to step in to give away best practices. In fact, towards the end of the webinar, I'm going to be giving the best practice guide that was given away by DHS to you guys. So we are talking about a situation where identity theft, identity compromise has become very, very common. What do? We see major conglomerates falling prey for it. They pay billions of dollars or millions of dollars, at least millions of dollars, as fines for the data breach. Not just the reputation that gets damaged, but also talk about the compliance violation. Every single attack that goes around is essentially around some or the other personally identifiable information. So you have compliance regulations popping up day in, day out. If folks from California are joining, you guys are aware of CCPA. California Consumer Privacy Act. So what do we do about it? How do we ensure that we have complete track of who has what access? So that is something that you need to take note of. We have major conglomerates again. In fact, I have a case for you where Deloitte, known to be one of the best cybersecurity consulting agencies, had a cybersecurity breach. Ironical, right? They ended up not just losing credibility, but also losing a lot of dollars. So it all boiled down to a simple problem of them not having two-factor authentication for an administrator account. It's as simple as that. Attackers try to exploit the smallest of the small vulnerabilities. So be aware of what is going on. The first and foremost thing is to identify how your infrastructure is set up. So that's the first recommendation that I have for you. And when we're talking about recommendations, we always stumble upon some of the other security models, do we not? So there's zero trust that's been going around for quite some time now. They talk about authentication and authorization first. They talk about the least privileged approach, and they also have this this recommendation of considering that there's a breach always. So is this enough as to how attackers operate? Is this enough to counter the attackers? I would rather say this isn't a very proactive approach when it comes to cybersecurity. It's just like having a couple of security measures and praying or hoping that nothing goes wrong. What you'll need to do is to look for a model that is adaptive. That's the baseline right here. They're getting really smart. They, in fact, have AI and ML working along side. They have bots that are extremely sophisticated that can crack passwords and credentials in a matter of seconds. So what do? We will need to look for a model that factors in the possibility of how unpredictable these attack vectors could be. So we need to start with the most basic building block, which is getting the right access given for the right user. So we're talking about finding out ways to check if we can make the entire access management adaptive. So we will need to look for ways that make it contextual. When I say adaptive, it is contextual that I intend to mean. We're talking about administrators inside the organization. We're talking about service accounts inside organizations. So other critical stakeholders being able to access only upon the right authentication, only upon the right context in place. So when that gets set right, you would not be under the pressure to monitor. So we're talking about setting up a couple of factors like risk prioritization. So how would you assess who's the riskiest user? Would you be able to look for factors that give you the top users who are the most vulnerable in your organization? Can you prioritize based on the accesses that they have, based on the data that they hold, based on the services and applications that are mapped to their account? It starts right there. Once that part of it is set, you go on to draw baselines for these users. You try to understand a pattern of their usage. You verify the usage. If there's a deviation, you should be in a position to be notified. That's something that you'll need to take into consideration. Going forward, as you mature as an organization, it's important that you have systems in place that test these policies every now and then. So get the right certifications in place. Check if there's an access privilege for a user. So have practices in place that consistently investigate and evaluate the privileges that someone has over an asset or a resource. So manage the usage right. And obviously, the last bit of it is going to be to course correct. Adjust your posture. So if there's something going on wrong, if you've got notifications saying that there's this deviation, a user of this sort was not supposed to access, but then there's a deviation, adjust your policy to meet the requirement. And as you go about setting this model of adaptive access, checking usage, managing usage, and discovering any new requirements that are coming up, you also become compliant to a lot of regulations out there. So try and be as adaptive as possible. Check and have a model that can continuously assess any risk out there in your system and can deflect a threat. So that's the model that I've got for you, which is called the CARTA, Continuous Adaptive Risk and Threat Assessment. That's something that you'll have to have in mind when you put your identity best practice or identity security in place. So if I were to break it down one level further and simplify it for you, it all starts with two elements, your data security and your identity strategy going hand in hand. So when you get your identity access management mapped like your data security or data access governance, most of the problems no longer exist. We're talking about the right entitlements given to the right users. Most of the times, if you're able to find out as to what went wrong, it would probably be one small entitlement mistake. We are talking about organizations and enterprises having hundreds of such modification requests flowing into the help desk day in, day out. If we were to take the manual approach, chances are pretty high that the administrator might commit an error, might probably forget to remove an old privilege. So how do you go about doing this? Can you have context associated with entitlement management? And that's something that you'll need to ponder upon. And as you go about granting access to users, can you make it adaptive? Can you check if the user is who he or she claims to be? So this is something that you can also think about. So going forward, I'd want to propose this model of data security over identity and access management. Most of the time, the challenge is when organizations try and come up with strategies, they do not start at the level of business strategy. They try and start at the very process. As a matter of fact, in this case, it could be your cloud access security brokers or your user behavior analytics or your data loss prevention. So how do you work your way top to bottom? So it's best if you start with your business strategy. It's best if you understand what your business's ultimate goals are, because for certain companies, data could be the most critical resource in the organization. If that is the case, you start right there. You prioritize which resources in your organization are critical. You find out who are the users who have access to those resources. You have an analytics module that closely works to check who's using or accessing a specific resource or data at a particular point in time. And with that as your input, start setting up your IAM, start setting up your data loss prevention. It's basically trying to find out the common ground. How do you prioritize identity management and access management over each other? You have the best security policies in place, great. You have a provision to orchestrate the whole thing or automate the whole thing, great. But then start at a business strategy level and let it trickle down to your identity access management or your user behavior analytics for that matter. And as a matter of fact, if you get this aspect of it right, it obviously is going to reflect right at your endpoint or your cloud or your data files as well. So that's a data security strategy that I've got for you. So going forward, what we've done so far is we've tried to understand what could be the possible problems, what could be the possible strategies that you could adopt. So I'd like to call it identifying phase. That's the first phase that I've got for you. We just got over with that phase. There are four more phases right here. So we were talking about a five-phase cybersecurity strategy, right? We started off understanding what sort of models to use, how do attackers generally operate, the possibility of us understanding and acknowledging the fact that an attacker could be in your system as we speak, and the importance of having an adaptive system in place. So that's the first bit of it, trying to check, go around your organization, see who's got what privileges, see who's got what accesses, get that all mapped, get that all documented, and then go forward. So the next four phases are going to be protection, detection, response, and recovery. When it comes to protection, again, it boils down to figuring out who your privileged users are, trying to draw an identity security roadmap, checking if their entitlements are assigned right. When it comes to detection, it is again going to be around analyzing your user's behavior. If we are talking about insider threats, this has to be your go-to solution. How do you find out those events that deflect the radar? How do you not get a false positive on a brute force attack? So these are certain things that you'll have to have in mind. So detection is going to be the next phase. The next one is obviously response. How do you counter a potential security threat? And the last phase is recovery, just in case if something goes wrong, all right? Even before you could step in and remediate if something goes wrong, you will need a strong recovery strategy to get back. So that is very much the idea. We just got done with the first phase where we tried to understand what model of security to have in place and the possibility of how attacks happen. The next phase is going to be protection. So when it comes to protection, the first one that you'll need to take into consideration is the ones with the keys to your kingdom, privileged users. So have a identity access management solution or a SIM solution that can quickly get you insights into who's got what level of privileges, who's got privilege on which file, which resource across your organization. Once you're able to do that, start working your way into least privilege. Ensure that you remove unnecessary privileges that are given. Ensure that you follow the principle of least privilege where only necessary accesses are given, just in case if you can find out a solution that can do a proxy privilege or impersonation, that has to be your go-to solution, all right? So that's something that you'll want to monitor, and it works best when you have analytics around privileged usage, because many a times privilege escalation attacks go absolutely unnoticed, as most of the times it's the administrators or someone with the privilege initiating such an attack. So how do you counter that? So look for solutions that can check deviations in privileged user behavior. So controlling what accesses they have and having provisions to quickly recall a privilege is something that you need to consider. When it comes to recalling, one of the models that we recommend to you know, cybersecurity leaders is the just-in-time privileged access model. If you've got a model that can grant accesses for a specific span of time, only when required and can automatically revoke, you're going to drastically eliminate or reduce the possibility of privilege abuse. So if you can combine just-in-time access with your delegation, that is the best way to go forward. So we're talking about trying to get granular with just-in-time access. And another best practice, again, that I recommend to administrators is just enough access, which is very much around the least privilege approach. So if you have a just-in-time strategy that goes hand-in-hand with delegation, most of your privilege escalation problems are solved. A major cybersecurity breach reason, a major privilege abuse reason, major insider attack cost, we're talking about trying to resolve that, and the solution that you could probably go about experimenting or implementing is the delegation. So when it comes to doing it the Microsoft way, if we are talking about an AD organization, there are obvious challenges. The granularity isn't really great. Even if it's Office 365, again, you're constrained by a lot of roadblocks right there. And when we're talking about trying to do delegation, if you can find a solution that does not just do role-based delegation, but at an attribute level, if you can get the solution to do it for you, you can get multiple stakeholders on your system, because day in, day out, we keep having requests from the HR or maybe the line manager for some or the other identity access management problem. And when we try to make it simple for us, when we try to grant privileges, probably, let's say, for a short span of time, thinking that we'd revoke it back once the job is done, that's where most of the trouble lies. That's the culprit. So we tend to have problems where access privilege is given all the time. So I have a couple of recommendations towards the end of the webinar. I'm going to give you access to a set of free tools that lets you go across your entire Active Directory to find out who's got what privilege on what resource. That's a free tool, as a matter of fact. If you can make a report out of it, you'd be absolutely surprised by the number of unnecessary privileges to the number of unnecessary stakeholders in your organization. So you can start working your way from there, remove unnecessary privileges, check and look for solutions that can report on the entitlements that users have. And if a solution can get really granular at an attribute level, say, let's say the screenshots right here is the example of the tool that we've got at ManageEngine called AD360 that does the exact same thing. You can get to the extent of saying, if it's password-related privileges, I'm going to just let the help desk technician just reset the password and nothing else. You can get granular to that extent. Look for solutions that help you set such roles, assign those roles. And in fact, if the solution lets you probably impersonate, nothing better than that. Because lesser the number of accounts that have access to your actual target system, chances of you being secure better are absolutely high. So we look for solutions that require minimal intervention, minimal access. And in this case, if you have your delegation and your just-in-time access working hand-in-hand, it's going to be the best strategy to go forward with. So we've been speaking about granting the right access to the right users or the right privileges. Here, it's essentially about giving them the right entitlements. What if something goes wrong? Because in the Deloitte case that we just saw a while back, it was a matter of them not having an MFA set in place. The account that had the privileges got compromised. And just because they were not able to stop with a second layer of authentication, there was the problem. So have MFA in place. The simplest recommendation that I could tell you, but the one of the best ways to secure your organization. And another tip for you, if you're running Office 365, you could get to securescore.office365.com. It's a console within your Office 365 setup. You'd be surprised as to where your security loopholes are, and you'd be given a clear-cut map of what all you need to do and the recommendations that you need to follow. So this is a straightforward dashboard that's out of Microsoft. If you're running Office 365, Secure Score is what you'll be needing to look at. And when you get into the Secure Score dashboard, the score that MFA gets is about a 50 on a base score of, let's say, 500. 50 is given to MFA in addition to a lot of other practices. So you get the idea, right? Setting up MFA is going to make things a lot simpler. And another important advantage that organizations today have when it comes to setting up MFA is it's not really a big deal because your users don't need to be onboarded to an MFA. They do it all the time. They are very accustomed to the idea of having a second layer of authentication, let's say, for their Facebook or their Gmail or any other application that they use online. So it's quite easy, but then try and look for solutions that do your MFA again granular. You don't want multiple factors of authentication for the wrong stakeholder. Ensure that your MFA can be customized. The methods of MFA, be it the one-time password, or be it the text notification, or be it, in fact, even the face ID or the touch ID that comes with the smartphones, figure out which works best for which type of users and set that. So most of the time, like I earlier pointed out, the challenge is to get the users to get on board with your best practice or with your new security policy. When you try and make it simple for them with something like a touch ID or a face ID, it becomes all the more easy. So look for solutions, identity solutions, or security solutions that offer such factors of multi-factor. So I've got a couple of recommendations right here. besides the old ones like the security questions, you can also look at options like email verification, SMS verification, or push notification. Or if you're a Microsoft organization, you can use the Microsoft Authenticator, which is absolutely free. If you're already using Duo Security, please have it tied along with your major applications. You can use fingerprint, QR code, a couple of options like that, just listing a few. But then the killer functionality that I wanted you to know is setting up a second factor right at logon, be it Mac, be it Windows, be it Linux. If you're able to set up MFA right at logon, major security issues or cybersecurity threats can be mitigated. We're talking about administrator account being compromised. Let's say the attacker somehow got hold of the administrator password. I've got a quick demo right here for you. The administrator account, the password just got compromised. The attacker is trying to go forward with the login, all right? But then turns out the attacker is not able to proceed any further because the attacker is prompted for a verification code. And in this case, it necessarily need not be the verification code. It can be a time-based OTP or a much more personalized factor like Face ID or Touch ID, which only the admin has. So we are trying to solve a very fundamental problem of passwords not being enough, and if even credentials get compromised, if you have a second factor right at the Windows logon or Linux logon, most of the troubles are history. So this is something that you can try and implement. So this is the second recommendation that I had for you today. The third one is going to be, or the third step is going to be detecting. So many a times, it becomes really difficult for administrators because security solutions and identity solutions don't operate hand in hand. They work in silos. You need to probably export reports, make manual interpretations, or push those reports into your SIM solution and then wait for something to happen. So look for a solution that can tie in both. Detect if there's a security vulnerability, detect if there are privilege escalations, detect if there is anomalous behavior and notify you. So look for a solution that can do a 360-degree monitoring. And when it comes to cybersecurity, one most important takeaway is having a strong auditing in place. It's got two benefits. One, obviously, security. The next one is compliance. So you keep getting requests from your auditor all the time. We don't like that part of the year when our auditor wants a report for this, that, and this. We don't want screenshots on our reports. We want actionable insights. What if your tool lets you do that? Check for tools that can give you a full-fledged info on histories of any changes that are happening in your target systems. It could be Active Directory. It could be Office 365, and you'd be surprised by the number of interpretations that you can make, the insights that you can draw on multiple factors based on basic parameters like logon history. That could give you a lot of info. Factors like who's accessing what files. So though it might look like a very basic information, it could be the game changer when it comes to a cybersecurity breach or a cybersecurity attack. When it comes to doing a forensic analysis, it is going to be your lifesaver. So I'm going to take a small example of being able to detect some malicious activity with logon activity monitoring. It all starts with having a solution in place that can probably help you counter brute force attack. So how can you have your solution work in your favor with just logon auditing to stop a brute force attack? If you were to code it or break it down this way, a brute force attack is nothing but repetitive logon failures followed by one successful logon. So if you can have a solution that can understand such logic, that has that level of threat intelligence, or as we call it, correlation for that matter, if it can correlate a couple of events, all right, under a minute, 100 logon failures followed by one successful logon, that could be the rule that your threat intelligence or your correlation engine can use and audit and let you know. Not just that, if it can go one step further and stop the brute force attack from happening or shut down that endpoint while it's happening, it's all the more cooler. And when it comes to attackers, we know when they love to operate non-business hours. If you can keep a track on who are the users accessing, logging in, logging out at a non-business hour, that is going to give you insights as well. Remote desktop activity is something that you need to track. And when it comes to attackers becoming really, really smart, trying to not tip off any of your SIM solutions, they try to island hop. They don't reside on a single endpoint. They try to slowly spread their access or foothold across multiple applications or services or, in fact, endpoints for that matter. Right after that first device is compromised, they try and use the credentials, they try and use the privileges to quickly run basic reports on PowerShells to find out who's who. You'd be surprised as to how easy it would be to run just a five-line PowerShell script on a user who has no great privilege, but just a basic user, and get data with which you can bring down the entire organization. We are talking about just the read permissions that Active Directory gives normal users across the domain. So once that's there in place, the attacker is going to try and hop as many number of times possible and as many number of endpoints as possible. And even before you know, one of those endpoints or one of those user accounts that probably, let's say, was nested with another admin group, had that privileges, the domain admin credentials are compromised, the entire network comes down. The entire identity infrastructure is compromised right here. So we are at this juncture where it's not just on-prem systems that we're talking about. We'll also need to consider the possibility of the whole thing being an hybrid attack. It need not start just on an on-prem endpoint. It could be very much on an Office 365 account on the cloud. So look for solutions that can help you check what's going on in your Office 365 or your Azure AD. And in fact, the major challenges as organizations are going through this wave of movement towards hybrid, they tend to rely on third-party providers for getting on with the migration. So please do have a security checklist when you're getting this migrated on from on-prem to the cloud, or when you have a hybrid setup in place. Most of the problems, most of the security loopholes are exposed and attackers take advantage of it. So look for solutions that can audit logs and correlate across systems, not just on-prem, but also on the cloud. And if you can get them to talk to one another and draw insights and map that identity across platforms, that's the exact solution that you'll need to be looking at. All right, so look for solutions that do a 360-degree monitoring on your prem and on your cloud. It can be around GPO changes. It can be around changes to the file and folder permissions that someone has, the logon activity that they're doing, or some recently deleted file folder or anything of that sort. Some a user with privilege goes on and deletes, let's say, 100 users, deletes a critical file. So all of those activities happening across your servers, your files, if they can be audited and brought together under one dashboard, that's the kind of tool that you'll need to be looking at. All right? Just on-prem, I'm not really sure how helpful it is today. If you can get a solution that can do hybrid, that is the solution that you need to be looking for. And when it comes to having solutions like this to audit, the challenge is false positives. As administrators, as such, we have like 100 things to do. And when we keep getting multiple false positives, it becomes a little difficult and we tend to become a little complacent, thinking that, okay, again, it's another false positive, another day, let's go forward. So we don't want that. Because most of these solutions that we're talking about, the ones essentially doing security, have blanket values, have hard-coded thresholds. Not all users are the same. You would want to treat the results with a pinch of salt. So that's a problem. How can you look for solutions that, talk to one another, correlate the data for you, and help you not let a breach, all right, creep in? So how do you go forward doing it? There are a couple of factors that we've got for you as recommendations. If you want to start with, the first thing that you'll need to look at, as always, is who's got access to sensitive data if it's privileged users. And if there are users who have remote access, that's the kind of users who you need to be looking at. And obviously, if there was some misunderstanding in the organization and someone had the access, you'll need to be looking at the disgruntled users as well. So we have this problem of insider attack becoming a major reason for cybersecurity breaches and cybersecurity issues in organizations. So you start by looking at these sorts of users. And you start looking for solutions that can track the volume of activity, that can do a quick risk assessment and give you a list of top 10 users who have the most critical accesses, top 10 users who've had the most number of logon failures, the ones that accessed files and folders the most number of times, or a specific file or folder accessed for the first time, or a new application that got initiated, an exe file was run on a server. Things like that, if you're able to track all of that, notice changes in the pattern, that's a solution that you'll be needing to consider or evaluate. For your cybersecurity strategy, look for solutions that can do user behavior analytics. If I were to break down how user behavior analytics would look like, most of the times these attackers try and pretend to be normal users. So when they get hold of an access or an account, there's obviously going to be deviation from the actual behavior. So earlier I pointed out it's important for your security solution to be able to correlate or bring all of the log data from multiple touch points under one roof, map it to an identity. That's a very important baseline. So log collection and processing it across platforms is the first step towards successful detection in user behavior analytics. Once that's done, all right, with time, if your solution has machine learning or AI, all right, look for solutions that have AI and ML. If they can do that, they can start drawing baselines for every user. Let's say Jay is a user who operates from 10 a.m. in the morning to 8 p.m. in the evening. That's the normal working hour for Jay. So that being the case, a baseline gets drawn for Jay, and if there is a deviation in the time of the day when this access is happening, my account got compromised and the attacker tries to snoop in the middle of the night. The system is going to notify the administrator, not just one factor, but let's say a series of factors like the log on time, the files that the user is accessing, the endpoint from where the user is accessing, maybe the type of session, a remote session, the IP address from where they're accessing, the geographical location from where the access is happening, or even for that matter, the device footprint. So multiple such parameters get taken into consideration and baselines get drawn. And if there's a deviation, the anomaly detection engine should step in, compare the deviation, check if it's an actual threat, because we don't want false positives right here, and report it right away to the administrator. And it'd be even better if it could step in and stop that specific attack or user from progressing any further. So most of the times when, let's say if it's a ransomware that's initiated from an account with access or privilege, you'd have this specific behavior of files and folders being renamed into different extensions. They essentially get encrypted, right? If that's the case, the solution can pick up such deviation in file or folder modification and immediately stop that user. Let's say a user had access to critical files and folders and they want to cause damage to your organization. All they need to do is delete a couple of files and folders. If your system can sense such mass or bulk deletion, it can essentially step in and stop that from happening. A couple of cases which you'd want your UBA to do is checking malicious logons. If there are logon activities happening from devices that were not registered, that's something that you'd want to note. Different time of day, that's something that you'll want to note. And if logon is happening for a specific account from multiple devices, we were talking about lateral movement, right? If that's the case, then you would want to be notified about a lateral movement. Because most of the times when island hopping or hopping happens, it becomes almost impossible to pin down the user. So you will need a solution that can do that for you. When it comes to privilege abuse, you'd need to receive notifications when there are anomalous activities or activities of nature that are not usual. We are talking about bulk deletion of users, bulk modification, or new users being accessed or granted access to specific folders and files. That's something that you'll want to monitor. When it comes to data security or data loss prevention, you will need to have complete control over what are the files and folders someone is copying. If you'd want to step in and stop something, you'll need to know. If you'd want specific files and folders with, let's say, critical information like PII, your system needs to be able to track and keep note of such file integrity and stop users from deleting, copying, or modifying it and notify you at the same time. Obviously, there's going to be the problem of malware and notifying, and through and through, any anomaly for that matter needs to be notified. And essentially, if you can execute a couple of scripts or probably let your SIEM solution take forward, things are going to be favorable towards you. So we're talking about trying to do a couple of cases right here: malicious logins, lateral movements, data breaches, trying to mitigate threats, all of this as a part of your detection mechanism. So if you can get this right, your third step of detecting your cybersecurity threats is done. So most of the threats go unnoticed, or like I earlier pointed out, get figured at a very later stage. So you can respond to such threats if you have a user behavior analytics in place. Look for solutions that do that. The next one is going to be obviously right after you found out, what do you do to respond? So since you're looking for a solution that has an AI and ML powered system in it, it makes sense for you to stop such devious behavior with an adaptive authentication in place. When we're talking about risk scores being drawn for those users, let's say the users accessing from a different geography, so at a different point of time, from a different endpoint. So that means the risk score of users way beyond the usual threshold. So you will need to have or look for solutions that can step in and fortify your authentication or add a couple of extra layers through to your authentication. So look for solutions that can do adaptive authentication for you based on context, based on network address, the device security, things like that. If it can step in and stop a real-time hazard of that sort, you're going to be definitely thankful. It's more like an upgrade to your existing multi-factor authentication, but it understands context, it knows who's the user, and checks if the user is who they actually claim to be. So this could be a great response for insider attack as well, because for external threats, most of the organizations have great security solutions. For insider attack, adaptive authentication can be your go-to solution. And yes, we have multiple password attacks happening all the time. Some of the other credentials being compromised, the ones that are being enlisted out there online to be bought. So what do you do? How do you prevent credential stuffing? How do you stop users from making use of those leaked credentials or them installing a malware and doing a keyboard vault? How do you let the users set stronger passwords? It all boils down to that one question. So even if the credentials are compromised, we had MFA. But before that, if someone were to try and do a brute force attack or a password spray attack, a little complex version of brute force attack, but much smarter than a brute force attack, take one potential password, a password like password at 123. Because our existing systems cannot stop our users from having such weak passwords. That's how most of the IAM systems are. So how do you stop that? How do you respond to these problems? Most of the native solutions do not have a granular password policy. They let users set incremental passwords, and give them a chance, they are always going to just add one more number or one more character, and they set weak passwords that way. And most of the times, the password that they set is very predictable. You know what they're going to set, I know what they're going to set, and obviously the attacker also knows what they're possibly going to set. They're very predictable. That's a big problem. And when they start using dictionary words, a matter of seconds is all that the attacker needs. So there are a couple of basic challenges. On top of it, you have your users. No matter how hard you try to have practices implemented, somewhere or the other, you're going to write your password on a piece of sticky note and have it stuck right on top of the desktop. What are you going to do about that? So have a security solution that can fortify your passwords for a change. How can you stop your users from using any dictionary words? That's a cool way to increase your password entropy. How can you not let users use common patterns, patterns like first name, last name? Look for solutions that can stop users from using the name of the organization or keyboard vaults for that matter. Let's say password 12345, QWERTY, QWERTY. How do you stop users from using that, setting such weak passwords? It's all about going beyond the native limitation and looking for a solution that can fortify your existing password policies across target systems, not Azure, not Office 365, or not any other solution out there does this right. It's a big concern. MFA, great, but still, if you can get the first layer of security done right, make your passwords difficult to guess or not let your users set such weak passwords, most of the problem is solved. And on top of it, if you can have a system that can let your users know if they're setting a weak password or a password that's compromised, because what we've done is we've got an integration with Have I Been Pwned. Whenever you have the time, do check out Have I Been Pwned. It lets you go through a couple of databases across the world, ones that are on the dark web, ones that are out there. It tells you if your credential, the ones that you're currently using, are compromised. You'll be surprised how many places your account has been compromised or has been a part of an attack. So do check the website out, and that's an integration that we have, and we let users not use such exposed passwords. We're trying to minimize the possibility of an attack, and as you go forward, it's best you reduce friction for your users. How do you make it simple for them? Through and through, irrespective of what security best practice you have, you don't want your users to feel the pressure. You don't want your users to not adhere to your rules or your regulations or the best practices that you have. Make it simple for them. Give them what they want right where they want. So when you're trying to talk about passwords, give them all those recommendations right at logon. So we've covered four phases so far. The last bit of it is going to be recovery. You've got all the best practices in place. You've got all the recommendations that I've got in place. Despite all of that, something went wrong. Recovery is something that you can always rely on. Have solutions in place that do a complete Active Directory backup at an Active Directory object level, at an attribute level. And if the solution can let you roll back to a previous state without a restart, that's the kind of solution that you need to be looking for. So even if something goes wrong, let's say an attacker who had the privilege changes a couple of GPOs to get more access, you can always, right when the system notifies you, revert back to the previous case, revoke all the access that the attacker had. Most of the problems are around entitlements and the GPO modifications that happen while the course of a privilege escalation or a privilege attack. So do have a very strong backup and recovery system in place, because we are talking about just not file and folder access, but also PII. If you can get all of that backed up, even if there's an attack of a ransomware going on, you can always restore back to the original state. I have a couple of more minutes and a couple of more recommendations for you to quickly consolidate what we've discussed so far. We started by understanding the five steps. The first one was trying to identify what could be a possible threat or how do attackers work and what sort of models are going to help you reduce your attack surface area. So how do you dynamically adapt to threats that are out there? The next bit of it is to trying and protecting it. How do you harden your existing security settings? How do you make your password stronger? How do you track your privileged users and what functions they do? If you can detect such deviations, that's great. If you can detect such suspicious activity, that's all the more better. And the next bit of it is trying to respond to it by continuously checking what's going on, reviewing the access that they have, checking if there are any vulnerabilities in your system, and responding with an adaptive authentication. And the last bit of it was recovery, where you try to centralize all your data, where you try to ensure that you have a strong backup system in place just in case if something goes wrong. So what we've done is at ManageEngine, we've put together a couple of resources around all that I discussed. And these resources are available in addition to the two free tools, one for password security and another for going through who's got what access on your critical files and folders and on other groups. You could have access to all of that, and all you need to do is just drop a message and we'll email all of that to you. The solution that lets you do all of this is AD360. This is the one that I've been talking about for quite some time now. You guys have been lovely. Thank you so much for being patient. Thank you so much for going through the session. If you have questions, I'm going to be available for questions. Over to Jackie right now.
Great. Hey, that was a lot of information. I'm going to take my password on my sticky note that's underneath my keyboard and get rid of that right now. We do have a few questions coming in here. Inquiring minds want to know, so it looks like we have a few more minutes before the top of the hour. I will go ahead and let me just ask you, what endpoints can be secured using MFA?
Right, when it comes to MFA, you can talk about servers, securing applications, because identities, again, is another endpoint that I'd want to quote. That's a consideration that most of us fail to have. Start treating your identities as an endpoint. So identities, servers, applications, and your endpoints end-to-end. Yes, that's about it, yeah.
Okay, and let's see. Microsoft offers backup and restore. So what is the difference about your tool?
Right, when it comes to the granularity, Microsoft does have trouble. It does not offer the flexibility when it comes to getting to OUs or being specific about a specific set of objects or attributes, because most of the times when backups are restored, you don't get the right state. You don't get the right privileges before the attack. So we would want to look for solutions that can offer that flexibility in terms of the OU or specific objects and so on and so forth. And when it comes to a couple of more points, just one or two more, we can talk about the incremental backup. So every time when you try to make a backup with Microsoft, there's this problem of it clogging a lot of space because you do an entire backup. If Microsoft systems can do an incremental backup, that would be a great addition. That would be really helpful. All the changes that recently happened, if you can just have them tied into your backup, that's a wonderful way to do it. And the biggest bummer for me personally is not being able to search backups for objects. That functionality is not currently available. Look for solutions that can enable you to do such searches. Quickly skim through if there's a specific object that you'd want to point out and recover. That would be a cool addition.
That would be a bummer. Okay, well, how about one more question and we'll wrap this up. Does your tool perform AI-based risk assessment?
Oh, yeah, that's exactly what I was trying to say. AI-based, absolutely, yes. So we've got a machine learning system that goes through every single user activity, every single touch point, and every single event, tries to correlate all of this and draw baselines to detect any unusual behavior or, you know, unusual volumes of user management activity or the time of the day or lockouts for that matter. Yes, that is possible.
Okay. Well, we have some people interested in resources from you, so I'll pass that along, Jay, after the webinar. And just so you know, thank you so much for your expertise today. We really appreciate you taking the time with us. Thank you, audience, for attending today's webcast, sponsored by ManageEngine and presented by Redmond Magazine. Have a great day, and we'll conclude the webcast. Again, the recording will be available. We'll make that available to you soon. Thank you again.